I'm Dominic Hall, curator of the Warren Anatomical Museum at the Francis A. Kentway Library of Medicine.
One of medicine's most famous neurological cases, Phineas Gage, rests for eternity in the collections of this museum. Or at least, part of him does. Phineas Gage was the foreman of a crew of railroad workers in 1848 in Vermont. While blasting rock for the Rutland and Burlington Railroad, Gage set off a spark and sent a tamping iron through the left side of his face, through his eye, and straight through the top of his skull. The tamping iron flew through the top of his head, taking a significant portion of his frontal lobe with it. Amazingly, Gage survived the incident. Incredible, given the state of medicine in that day. Today, we're only allowed to touch Gage's skull with gloved hands. Gage, unfortunately, didn't receive this luxury while he was still alive. Sterilized medical gloves wouldn't be invented until 1890, so his doctor simply prodded and probed his wound with bare fingers to assess the extent of the damage. Even beyond the damage from the tamping iron, Gage probably received significant damage from infection. Gage was in a coma for some time, but he amazingly pulled through and woke up. So here's where it gets interesting from a neuroscience perspective. We know that our brains make us who we are. And we know that the frontal lobe is one of those brain areas that is conspicuously much larger in humans compared to other animals, including our closest evolutionary relatives, apes and monkeys. What happens if we take that part out? Now, the historical evidence is a bit tricky, but the most credible accounts of Gage after his injury come by way of his doctor, and they tell of his altered behavior, describing him as less capable, less temperate, and just not the same Gage. This was some early evidence that perhaps the frontal lobe plays a role in governing human behavior. Unfortunately, over time, this link between brain and behavior was just too compelling to pass up, and the stories became more and more florid. Some accounts, including some in modern times, suggested that the behavioral changes were so great that he couldn't hold down a job or that he abused his wife and children. Of course, Gage did continue to work successfully after his injury, and he couldn't have abused his wife or children if for no other reason than he didn't have any. Gage, while perhaps somewhat diminished, was still highly functional. In some ways, this may be even more of an impressive neuroscience lesson. The brain is an amazingly resilient organ, able to sustain enormous damage and yet still function. What we do know is that Phineas Gage provides us with evidence of the great plasticity of the brain even after serious injury. He was still highly functional, held the job, and even toured with his tamping iron by his side for years after the accident, until his death 12 years later. I'm here with Dominic Hall, the curator of the Warren Anatomical Museum. So can you tell us a little bit about how this skull came to be in the possession of Harvard University?
Of course. Gage dies in 1860. And when he dies in 1860, he's buried. Harlow, his physician, gets in contact with his mother sometime in 1866. And during that time, they correspond back and forth. And then in 1867, 1868, Harlow travels out to San Francisco, where Gage is buried. They disinter the skeleton. They take Gage's skull and the tamping iron, which may or may not have been buried with the body. You see conflicting reports. And then Harlow brings it back to Boston and deposits it in the Warren Museum in 1868.
So this tamping iron's engraved. Who's responsible for this and for the mounting and all that?
It's a great question. So in 1850, Henry Jacob Bigelow, who's a Harvard Medical School surgeon, invites Phineas Gage to campus, and mostly to substantiate the injury. It's not widely believed when the reports come out from Harlow in 1848. And so when Bigelow brings him in, he makes a life cast of Gage's head, and at that time deposits the life cast into the Warren Museum's collection. Gage donates the bar to the Warren Anatomical Museum. And at that time, it's unclear if it's Warren Museum staff, if it's Bigelow, but that's that time they write this sort of inscription on the bar and then create this presentation mounting to put it on display. And it was in display in the Warren Museum and has been in display in the Warren Museum since its donation. One of the sort of interesting side stories about the bar is that we know Gage comes back for it. And so in 1850, he donates it, but then sometime later, presumably in 1854, as I think was when we best localize it, he comes back, gets the bar, and then uses it when he's touring at medical schools and at Barnum's Museum in New York City and a couple other events. Gage has it with him through his entire life. So when he travels to Santiago, Chile to work on the stagecoach, he's got the bar. And then when he returns to San Francisco or goes to San Francisco to live with his mother, he has the bar. And when he dies, the bar stays with him. Some people suggest it was buried with him. We're not exactly sure. So when his mother donates the skull to Harlow, or gives the skull to Harlow, the bar comes along with it. And so it gets re-donated to the Warren Museum in 1868. And actually in the records of the Warren Museum, the original donor is Gage, it's crossed out, and John Harlow is written in.
These phrenology casts are from the collection of the Boston Phrenological Society, founded in 1832. The collection was donated to the Warren Anatomical Museum in 1847. Phrenology was a pseudoscience that measured skulls and inferred personality traits. It blossomed in popularity in the 19th century and heavily influenced criminology, education, psychiatry, art, and literature. Proponents claimed that the surface shape of the skull, with all of its bumps and lumps and crevices, told of fixed personality traits. Larger skulls were claimed to be the signifiers of greater intelligence, and larger bumps in certain areas were signs of stronger sense of cautiousness or poetic ability or faithfulness, for example. We, of course, now know that all of this is total bullshit. Very good.
So this is a cast of an individual named John. John was collected because he was microcephalic. He's actually of one of a series of seven members of his family, all have this condition, and he was put into a category by Spurzheim of individuals of diminished intelligence. This cast here is Felix Mendelssohn. Initially, the cast was taken because his father was a well-known philosopher, but at the time Spurzheim's sort of divining his system, Mendelssohn also makes his mark as a musician, and then he falls into the Spurzheim category of tune, or the sort of ability to create music, or the ability to hear and understand music. This third cast is Samuel Coleridge. It's one of three casts we have in the collection, two taken in life, one taken in death, and he was used as an example in Spurzheim's system of language, another one of the categories. And this last individual is someone known sort of at the time as Saint Simon, not a saint, but he was actually a French philosopher during the revolutionary period and then the post-revolutionary period. He actually, Spurzheim puts him in a category called acquisitiveness. Acquisitiveness meaning theft or the sort of propensity of to acquire. And other individuals in the category were well-known thieves. So my assumption is that they're putting Saint Simon in that category for maybe his theft of ideas. And this last head is actually just a typical symbolical head. This was a chart that people would have. These are all the faculties numbered, and that would correspond with like these examples of tune, language, math.
So if you had a bump on your head on number 14, then you presume to have more of whatever 14 was.
Exactly.
And if you're making it up, you know, based on your own system.
Well, the interesting thing is, I mean, it's clearly pseudoscience, but both Gall and Spurzheim were basing it on neuroanatomy. They're doing dissections of the brain.